I guess you might know me associated with Red Boot Records and perhaps some calling around. I have a couple of fellas on my panel today that I'll be introducing a little bit more formally in just a few minutes. Dr. Carl Anderson and Wade Driver. And Carl is filling in for Ken Bauer, who could not be here. We appreciate that very much. This session is on music. We would like to plan our hour and a half this way. I, as moderator, am supposed to do the first presentation, and then I will serve from then on as moderator, and the two gentlemen here will be the panelists. I understand our plans were to have each presentation first and then hold your questions until later. However, we don't want to stymie that. If you have something that's just burning that you think would contribute to our discussion of music, please feel free to ask a question, and we'll do our best to answer it for you. The gentlemen here that are taping this program is being taped, and we're going to ask, please, that you... It may be a little bit difficult to walk around there, but you can use that microphone in the center or this one here for you folks in this general area, or if you so desire, you can use the one I'm having here. I believe those three are all we have, but please, even though we all possibly could hear you, these tapes, they're being professionally taped here, and it will not go on the tape good unless you're reasonably close to a microphone. So please do that when you want to ask or respond to a question. The program that we have laid out, I'm going to spend just a few moments, and this was originally going to be Ken's topic, and I was going to do Carl's, but we've made a little change here. I'm going to take the subject programming with music. Carl will be talking about some of the little more technical things or the definition of music, and he'll be having a discussion with you there. Wade will be getting into some of the recording techniques and things that how we record and use music for square dancing. Are there any more chairs back? Over here is a few. Okay, my subject, again, is programming with music. Manning Smith, a highly regarded caller and round dance instructor from Texas, had a great deal to do with the development of square and round dancing in Texas. Also in many other places, as quite a few of you probably know. Who can forget Manning's famous Manning's Mixer? Many of us still carry and use this very effective mixer. Manning, the reason I mention his name, Manning, in an article written for Sets and Order magazine some time back, I recall it well because I've used this many times, gave a definition of the term dancing. What is dancing? And I have one here from Webster, too, and I think I like Manning's better. But Manning says this. He defined dancing as dancing... Quote, dancing is man's attempt to interpret music. I'd like to have you think about that just for a few minutes. Man's attempt to interpret music. If we are going to, if this is so, and I believe it is, we need to put some thought on it in selecting our music for square dancing. If this is so, each pattern call, each piece of choreography, and especially every singing call has its own personality and will be interpreted, at least to some degree, by the dancers. Studies have been revealed that certain kinds of music played in the chicken house actually raise the quantity of egg production, and apparently the grateful hens, by the same token, dairy cattle seem to produce more milk under the influence of specialized music. Were y'all aware of that? Indications are that factory workers produce more with fewer problems when listening to certain types of music. The specially prepared soundtracks behind movies and TV really accent the scenes and add tremendous emotion. The doctor and the dentist visits seem a little less painful with music. What would we all do if we didn't have the music from our radios, our stereos, records, tapes, and so forth? What would a Broadway play be like without music? What would church services be? Just, what would our world be like without music? Webster's definition I have down here at the bottom says, a series of rhythmic and patterned bodily movements usually performed to music. Defining dancing once again. It is obvious that music helps make the world go round. It is true that music helps us express our moods, whether we're happy, sad, mad, anxious, loving, nervous, calm, romantic, or proud, or what have you. A little squeal here. I'm trying to find which one it is. Keep going. Does it not make sense that the music we use for square dance tips should be carefully selected to help establish the mood we are seeking at that time? Also, the choreography should be chosen that best fits the style of music and the desired mood, and you'll be hearing more about that later. Is it good programming to dance every tip with slow but snappy rhythmic music about 126 to 128 beats per minute, with smooth flowing choreography, properly styled, with no sounds from the dancers and smiles on their faces? Is it? Let me read that again. Is it good programming to dance every tip with slow but snappy rhythmic music about 126 to 128 beats per music per minute, with smooth, flowing choreography, properly styled, with no sounds from the dancers and smiles on their faces? I'm tempted to say yes, yes, yes. However, I think the key words here are every tip. If we use that same old hoedown record each time and all the singing calls sound alike, I think we may be taking some of this extra fulfillment from the dancers, and they are not getting a chance to interpret the music in their own style. The use of a variety of background music, I feel, is one of a square dance caller's most valuable aids, and I'm coming every day to get back to this more and more. Sometimes when all this fancy choreography and stuff that we're doing and everything seem like you're just not hardly getting it, you can go back to a certain good singing call or a certain piece of music and it seems like it's just a trick. It is perhaps even more important during class time than any other time in the life of a dancer. A caller with outstanding patter presentations can entertain a floor and normally have a good dance. Yet even here, no matter how good he is with choreography, he can be even better when he uses a variety of music to accent various choreography patterns. I'm going to just spend a few moments here and the remaining time that I have and do away with my prepared thing there, and I'm going to do this just like I would if I was calling a dance. And I'm not going to take a whole dance because it would take too much time. But I want to give you my personal interpretation of what I would think about in programming. And I'm going to take one, two, three, four different tips as I think in my planning a program. And, of course, programs differ in a festival, whether you're calling a home dance or a traveling, a club dance, a special. They all have some sort of different theme or something. You might have to think a little differently. However, just for just for our sake, since we can't do everything, let's say we're calling, we've been booked in here in Philadelphia to call an anniversary dance for the Bells and Bows, or I don't know if they have a Bells and Bows here, but we'll just say that in Philadelphia. So this was what I would do. The first tip, my hoedown selection, which is just as important as the singing call, my hoedown selection, I have three or four I've just pulled out right out of my case, and I really probably should have spent more time on trying to give every record label certain status. But these are records that I'm calling right now, and it's just the way that I would do it. And I wouldn't use the same one every night, but I'm going to just give you a little bit of two or three or maybe four in each category and mention why I think that way. And maybe we can get some additional response here. My first tip, I'm going to use a real snappy hoedown, one of the most popular around, and get a good feel. It's not going to be perhaps the most driving one I'll use, but it's going to be a real good one. And I have called with several callers lately, and I find more callers than not using this one. I would use this for my first tip. Anybody know what that is? Okay, that's Mountain Dew on Chaparral. If any of you would like to get the number on these, we'll lay them up here. I think most of you will know them. Okay, the first tip then I have here in my record case, after I use that for the introductory choreography, and we're not going to talk choreography, this is the music effect we're after. One I'm using now for the first tip, the philosophy, if that's the term to use, behind my first tip would be, you want a nice tune that sort of gets things going and dancers dancing. You don't want it too hard. You want it something they will relate to. Just set a good pace for the dancers. Could be an oldie, but I have a tendency, away from all, not to start off the dance with an oldie, unless it really, once in a while I'll use a classic. But here's one that, this was one of mine that we did a while back called Gonna Have a Party on Red Boot. The Red Boot boys helped me out on it. It just seems like a good one, and it's worked well for me now for about a month. That's on Red Boot. Another one I use for the first tip a lot of times. Here's one that I recorded earlier. This version is by Elmer Sheffield on ESP. It's called Rolling in My Sweet Baby's Arms. Everybody in the world knows this tune, but it's a good one. It's one of the few old ones I would start off with. Okay. Here's one Wade just came out with that our boys in the Red Boot Quartet have jumped right on, and we do it in our concerts, and we're going to be where we're already doing it. Wade, Once in a Million, One in a Million. This is one of the Stratton Brothers. This is a little gospel feel to it. Hundreds of others that with the same type of thing that would be a good one. Okay, moving quickly to the second tip, the way I would do if I was calling for the Bells and Bows here in Philadelphia. This hoedown I might have started with and used the other one, but I sure, if y'all are like me, I'm starved for more hoedowns, and I don't know why we don't all produce some more and better hoedowns instead of so many singing calls. I keep telling myself that, but we just don't do it. After Cal's Ragtime Annie there, well, we're gonna do that. This was been out a couple of years or so on K-Locks. I like to use this for tip number two. It's a good one, Fire. That nice leap to it, and I love to use that hoedown. There's two or three of Wade's I have in there too that I would use a lot on the first and second tip. I have it down there. That Hot and Sassy is one of my favorite. Well, let's go to the singing calls for tip number two. Let's see. Tip number two, my thinking is, I like to use my real zinger. I want to really get them up and going and moving. And about every 2 or 3 weeks, here comes a new tune that I think is perhaps the best one as far as I'm concerned for that time, with a lot of drive to it that I can get a lot out of it. Now I have, this one is just about passed, and now I'll get it in order. But I think the second tip is very important, because your patter call, you really started zinging them up pretty good the second tip. You're looking around to see who all you can sight on the rest of the night. And but this singing call is a good one. This is on El Dorado. I'm sure a lot of you have this one. I have had tremendous success with it. Okay. I understand I had to cut down the contra people a while ago. Point me out that way. Mercy's sake. If you can't get them excited with that record, there's something wrong. Late Night Loving Man, El Dorado. It's a good one. It's a cross between a boogie woogie and Jerry Lee Lewis and all of that. Now here's one I've been doing. This was on Red Boot by a young fella right here, Mr. Mike Hoos. Hang On Swangin'. This is perhaps their best-selling record right now. There's a little girl in our neighborhood. Her name is Charlotte Johnson, and she's really looking good. Okay. That is also a good one. They're having eating chocolate pie contests and swinging contests and everything back in Tennessee over that record. And I suppose that helped. But we got a good cut on it and having a lot of success. Mike Hoos right here was the one that recorded that one for us. And here's another one we just picked up. This is one of Wade's. This one really has the drive to it. I've only done this one about twice, but it'll also be used in my second slot for a while. Am I still too loud? Knock, knock, knock. We'll call that and wait. Okay, that one gets on with it. It's on rhythm. Knock, knock, knock. Okay, now I'm getting all messed up here.
Did you bring any with you, Wade?
It'll be released April 5th.
Okay, moving right on, and I have two more tips, and then we're going to move to something else. My third tip is normally, not always, but 90% of the time, I'll do a little bit of a workshop. I like to pick out something that will be my featured little special for the evening. It might be a CALLERLAB selection, or it might be something else. Might be something from a list up above. But whatever I'm using, it might be just a piece of fancy choreography, but I would use it as kind of a workshop tip. And
it's over your head.
Okay.
That workshop tip's over his head.
Hello up there.
We'll give you a little
more. It's all right, as long as they can hear back there. Y'all getting it from over here? Okay. Same thing here. Okay. So on the third tip, and this to me is one of my, this makes my dance, and after doing the workshop, which is always featuring the choreography just a little bit, with a little smoother style hoedown. Here's one that I use for that on Joe Pat label called Sunshine. Oh, okay. Okay, that's a nice little rhythm. You don't want, or I don't want, a lot of lead instruments in my, when I'm doing a lot of workshopping or good choreography. I want just rhythm. Of course, another one is Rock Island Ride on Red Boot. I use a lot. Here's Hot and Sassy, and all of the rhythm type hoedowns. The singing call that I would pick for the third tip, and if I don't watch, I get into a rut on this by using the same ones, but I want some old favorite or something, and I can just hash the call, and in all probability I will have a figure written that will utilize the piece of choreography I've used in my workshop. And it really helps make the dance, I think, to do that. And just two or three quickly, here's an oldie I've used 5,021,000 times on hi-hat called When You Wore a Tulip. Excellent piece of music. It's one of my favorite songs anyway. I just love it, and it really works well for me. Another one... Here's one that Flippo did earlier. I used it a lot, and just lately this one came out, and it's an excellent one. A familiar sing-along type thing that works good. You callers that just hash the figure, use it. Every street's a boulevard. Every street's a boulevard in old New York. Every street's a highway to a dream. Good piece of music. Chaparral, Every Street's a Boulevard. Okay. For this third tip, here's one I've also used probably more than I have that one. This is, to me, is a classic. I hear people singing. I had to take that off. I just love that piece of music. And Joe Pat came out with another good rendition in 2/4 rhythm, which Carl will tell you about in a few minutes, to the same tune. Here's one that I did a couple of years back. This has been a real good seller. This is a... I'm on tip number 4. I've already gotten ahead of myself. But I'll just go ahead with it. On the fourth tip, I would be bringing the dancers down just a little bit. And using these sing-along or slower types, 4/4 tunes. This is one that went well for me. This is a shuffle beat. If you're familiar with Ray Price music, he uses this on 90% of his stuff. So what have I said? On the fourth tip, we've had them up there. We're coming down just a little bit. And I have been known to drive them real hard on the fourth tip and then go to that on the fifth tip. Kind of depends on the dance. That was Red Boot, Don't You Ever Get Tired by Don Williamson. Thank you. Okay, this is, I think I'll stop there. You can go on and on with this, and there's a lot of different opinions, perhaps, but the point I would like to make, again, is that music, if we are going to allow the dancers to interpret the music through dancing, let's just keep that in mind as you hear the other presentations. And we hope that you've enjoyed or got something out of our comments here. Just quickly before we get to Carl, does anybody have any questions or anything you'd like to ask us while we're on our subject? Okay, sir, would you please step up to the mic?
All I want to say is, where is all this air conditioning we heard about?
Where is all the air conditioning?
Outside in the rain.
It apparently is not in here because it is warm, isn't it? The young man asked me if it was warm, and would you, John? Appreciate it. Okay. Are there any other comments? Our next panelist from Stillwater, Oklahoma, Dr. Carl Anderson. Carl has a BS degree in music, a master's degree in school administration, and a PhD in school administration. He is an accredited caller education specialist. He owns the Gold Star label that he purchased from Cal here and associated with me on GNW and Gold Star Records. And he has done lots of caller schools and lots of work in the field of music. And without further ado, let's bring him on with a nice hand, Dr. Carl Anderson.
Thank you, Don. I don't want you to get excited. He said I was a doctor, but I'm not the kind that'll do you any good. PhD means piled higher and deeper, so we'll get those kind of jokes out of the way right now, and we'll get on with the situation. In 1981, I had the privilege of working at the CALLERLAB Convention in Kansas City. Worked with two outstanding young men, Curly Custer and Johnny Wyckoff. My assignment at that time was to talk about the elements of music. We defined music, we talked about rhythm, we talked about harmony, we talked about melody, we talked about pitch, intonation, and all that kind of dry, boring stuff. We announced at that time it wasn't our intent to make musicians out of anyone, and I think that our fears were, we didn't have to be fearful, because I don't think we did. In 1982, CALLERLAB again conducted a program on music with Daryl Clendenin, Daryl McMillan, and Pat Barber. They concentrated on the concepts of harmony and programming. For those of you who were in the lovely community of Reno with us at this time last year, this year, in trying to keep with the theme that's been set for the music presentation, I'm going to talk about music in general. I'm going to talk about the feel, the variety of music. We hope it doesn't get too technical. It won't get too technical. We won't let it get too technical. That's one thing about music that you've maybe have been exposed to. Don mentioned to you some research that had been done about chickens laying bigger eggs if they're playing rock and roll or whatever the research was. Believe it or not, that there is a great deal. There's a field of music therapy with a great deal of expertise that goes into it. That tape that you hear while you're in the dentist chair is no accident. It is scientifically programmed, because there has been proven beyond any doubt that there is a relationship between pain and music and the kind of music. That there's a relationship between all kinds of the environment within which we live. And as Don pointed out, certainly music is a part of our everyday environment. Whether we're in the car, whether we're at home, we can be by ourselves just whistling out in the yard. Music is a definite part of our environment. It's with us all of the time. It's a very important weapon for the square dance caller. There may have been a time when you would hear a record and say, that is a square dance record. That is no longer true today. It comes from the sounds you hear come from a myriad of different kinds of styles and classifications of music. What I have is a tape, if our multimedia presentation doesn't fail, that we're going to try to use the sound system. The total amount of the time of the tape will take about 8 minutes and 31 seconds for those of you who want to count, and if my watch was correct. We'll go through this, and then I'll raise some questions, and I hope to get a little discussion going. That's where I'm headed right now, okay? If you don't discuss, I got a backup system that we can go ahead. But that's my intent, okay? Let's listen. Put a chill up and down our spine as the parade goes marching by the street. It's interesting as you listen to a march. It has everything you want. This is the basic melody that we all know when the band comes by. You'll hear different sections build here in just a minute. Down a little bit, the thing is going to build all the way through. It crescendos until it just gets so exciting at the end you're just not going to be able to stand still. You're going to be patting your foot. Here goes the drums. Something like you might hear with this 46-second rendition played by the 101 strings. I think you might recognize it as September Soft. Song fades. We will have the same song, September Song, with a different treatment. Perhaps you will recognize the vocal styling of Mr. Willie Nelson. Of Mr. Willie Nelson.
Youngsters,
that we used to call that a standard dance tune. We have standard tunes in the repertoire today in the square dance area. I'm sure that many of us can think of several. Let's talk about some of the relatively new ones that are out. 5'2" that are not quite in this vein, but similar. Standard tunes can be used and are used in our square dance movement. One of the record companies, DNR, sometimes presents a big band sound, similar to this, perhaps. Stan Kenton, Dynaflow. Familiar with in terms of styling, don't overlook the possibility of it coming into being one day soon. Henry Purcell's Trumpet Prelude. This has been done in a popular vein right here. Many of you have heard the Hooked on Classics. They took this particular theme, Beethoven's Fifth, to do that particular arrangement. Overlook the possibility of the fascinating and exciting Latin rhythms as we listen to the Terrioka. Johnny Wyckoff has one out called The Lady in the Gardenia Hair. Gardenia Hair, the lady. Just happen to have it, right? Just to prove that there are these kinds of things. Square dance to a polka type rhythm. Thank you. Would it be possible to revisit the gay 90s and think of it as the possibility of a square dance tune, perhaps even using barbershop quartet type sounds? Lily, for those of you who are wondering who that is, that would be the goal of folks like me. Would it be possible to take even a more contemporary sound like rock and roll or rhythm and blues and transform it into a square dance tune? He promised me $25. Now, guys, there are different kinds of rhythms. This thing changes rhythm, okay? We're kind of on a rock beat, a blues beat at this time. Listen to it change in the terms of sound. You'll hear the rhythms actually change underneath it if you concentrate very hard. We move from the rock sound to a ballad type orientation. Listen to the rhythmic structure. Smooth outline, and you've got a ballad, not unlike old Willie. Within that same tune, a harder rock. Okay, those are examples of the kinds of availability that we have in terms of rhythmic activities to us today. Variety. Variety is the spice of life. For those of you who may not have recognized that those last, 128 beats or so, they happen to be one of a recent recording by Mr. Wade Driver, one of our panelists, on the rhythm label. The activity that we are participating in is very important, and we have a very, very powerful weapon. Don talked to you about the idea of programming, of lifting the dancers. We have the psychological capability of doing that. We can let the music work for us a great deal. That can become our weapon. Let's take a look at and consider, please, if you will, the theme of this CALLERLAB convention. Dancers, our prime consideration. We have a consideration to the dancers for a good many of things, not the least of which is entertainment. We can entertain by variety. We can entertain by the very music that we choose to play or by the music that we choose not to play. We can get in a rut. I see a hand frantically waving back there. Either you want to say something.
Or,
oh, your wife. Okay.
That's all right. We'll take care of it. Don't worry about a thing.
I thought I was on a roll, too. Oh, well. I was going to ask a series of questions like what is music? I was going to ask another, and hopefully get a discussion going. I was going to ask another kind of question like, what is distinctive about the music that we use in the square dance movement? After the example that I used, I would hope that we would say, it's not really distinctive. You cannot any longer today tell from a record that is definitely a square dance tune because of the variety of rhythmic patterns that we have available to us, because of the variety of instrumentation that the record companies are using, with the electronic sounds that the record companies are using. That gives us, the caller, a powerful and potent weapon. Saying don't work on choreography. I'm saying that just by the use of your records, planning, thinking, and aiming your program, as Don discussed, to a given point or series of points of raising and lowering the level of the emotional level of the dancer throughout the evening causes a great deal of entertainment on their part. One of the interesting things about music is that it is at least 50% psychological. There are so many, it's really amazing. If you're ready to sit down and study music, music is a science in one sense, very closely related to the mathematical area, because it works with acoustics, vibrations per second, and those are precise, very precise. They're very measurable. It's very mechanical, if you will. Yet music is also an art, because there are so many things that you can do with each independent element of music that causes different effects. Think about it when you go to a movie and you hear the music building in the background. You can tell if he's going to kiss her or he's going to kill her or they're going to drive off in a speeding car. The music gives you that clue. It's a psychological setting that takes place, and we have that same weapon, and we can use that same weapon on our dance program. It's just as powerful for you as it is for the movie producers. Believe me. Honestly, it is. I've tried to give you an example of the different kinds of availability you have, from the march to the terioka, to rock and roll, to rhythm and blues, from bluegrass to ragtime in New Orleans. It's all there. If you select your records carefully, if you plan your dance, if you utilize this weapon that you've got. Do you have any questions? Do you have any comments that you would like to make? Then I would like to thank you for your time and your indulgence, and at this time turn it back over to our chairman, Mr. Don Williamson.
Thank you, Carl. We really appreciate it. I guess I just have to say this. We just recently have opened up our new studio at home, and we've been doing quite a bit of research. Some of the things that we were concerned about some of our recordings, we were wondering why we weren't getting exactly the same thing back from the pressing plants in Nashville and so on as we were sending down there. And we found out there's a lot of technical things involved. Has to do with the machines you play it back on. It has to do with the type of speaker you use, the type of cartridge you use, the tones and things you put on it before you send it to be pressed. And there's just an awful lot of technical things that these fellows that are in the recording business know about. So in doing this research and working with some of the people in Nashville, we took about, I don't know, maybe 15 different labels of what we considered the top labels, some of the best, what we consider hits in the square dance field down there, and we played them and analyzed and got the specialists down there to do that. And the reason I say this is that the label that was picked out of, and Wade didn't know I was going to say this, but the label that was picked out of all the ones I took down there that technically was the best recorded was rhythm. And I think Wade has done a good job with his recordings, and all of us use quite a few of them. He's going to talk to us a little bit about some of the methods of recording and the things that the way he gets that good sound. So, from Houston, Texas, Rhythm Records, Circle D Records, he's a new member of our board of directors. Let's have a nice hand for Wade Driver.
Thank you, Don. That's a very nice surprise. I would, before I get into recording, since Dr. Anderson was so nice as to play a little bit of that song a while ago, I got to brag. Everybody's got to brag on their kids. I have a 17-year-old punk rock drummer at home who happens to belong to me. At least his hair isn't orange anymore. It was for a while. But, you never know. But he is a talented musician, and he wouldn't allow me to put his name on the label because he was afraid his friends would laugh at him. But he wrote the entire musical score for Hooked on Elvis, and all written and played all the drum work and did and put that whole song together for me, and I thought he did a nice job, and I'm kind of proud of it. All right. He still got orange hair, but, in recording, they're really... There are no secrets, really. It's a funny kind of a business. I went into it really out of desperation, I suppose. At about the time 8 years ago when I went full-time calling, I happened to like, I'd only been in Houston about a year, and I had fallen in love with Texas-style country and Western music. Not country music, but country Western music, all right? This is the reason why Don and I coexist so well. He cuts good, solid Nashville country music. I cut Texas country music, country Western music. But we can do the same tune. They can both be good, but they won't sound alike because it's got a different flavor. And so back to what Carl was saying a while ago, variety not only in what you use, but variety in what we allow you to use by cutting for you, hopefully is what gives you a successful calling program. But when you go in there, you know, people like Don, who's been in the business for years, you either have a knack for this silly business or you don't, and that's about what it boils down to, because you try to follow basically the same rules, which I don't mind going over step by step what we do, and then you just rear back and make a good, hopefully good guess as to whether you're doing it right. But what I'd like to do is start right from day one when you decide, I think I'll make a record, okay? Or I'm speaking of a producer now. From that point until the point where he has a finished product to ship out. First of all, you have to select a recording studio, unless you happen to own your own. And as I don't. I rent studios. I use a combination of about four. And the reason I use four isn't that I get mad at one and move somewhere else. It's that, well, at one point it was, but it's not anymore. But I use three studios in Houston and one in Nashville. The reason I use two cities is I use two sets of musicians. The one in Nashville, there's no question, are the A-team. They're all there. Their price is also the A-team. But I don't really get a better sound out of them than I get out of Houston, because I'm going to cut it my way anyway. But you get a different sound. All right, now, for example, I happen to like fiddles, banjos, guitars, and steels. I'm going to have it on everything I cut. And if you keep cutting in the same place with the same musicians the same way, it's like a cookie cutter. Every song is going to sound alike. Would like to avoid it. We can't always be successful, but would like to. So as a result, we use different studios. Because the ambience in each studio is different. And you can cut the same, exact same song the exact same way in two different studios, and they will not sound alike because of the acoustics and, again, the ambience of that particular studio. If you cut a song, say, in one studio and put the vocal on there and you've got about like you want, then you take the tape to another studio and mix it, it's not going to sound like it did in the first one. It just, you hear things different, all right? My voice coming through this very same amplification system in a room four times as large would not sound the same way. The tones would be different. It disperses before it gets to you. A lot of technical things, but basically, point is, I use different studios to get different sounds, okay? Now, I'm working on my kid. He's already got his up where he's brilliant already. He can do all of his parts. Mine hasn't got that far yet, all right? But you have to select a studio based on the equipment that it has. It may or may not have the latest Jim Jicks and buttons and lights and whistles, but it needs to be good, solid, well-maintained equipment. You have to decide, do I want to use an 8-track, 16-track, 24-track, 32-track studio? When we cut on tape that's 2 inches wide. Now, unless you use 8-tracks, which I don't, but on a 16, 24, 32-inch track studio, the tape's about this wide, and each instrument is laid down on its own little track. So you can listen to any one of those instruments separate, isolated, in combination with one or more of the other instruments. You have to sit down and say, all right, if I'm going to use five musicians and one vocal, the end, it would be rather senseless of me to pay the price for a 24-track studio, all right? That an 8 or a 16 would accomplish what I need. Bear in mind, when I say each instrument on a separate track, I personally put my drums on six different tracks, the snare on one, the tom on one, the bass on one, the hi-hat on one, cymbal on one, so on. Okay, you need to isolate your instrumentation as much as you can. So, based on how much you want to spend and how much separation you want of your instrumentation and how many vocals you're going to do, you select a studio based on its quality of equipment, quality of its engineer who operates the control board, and quality of the size of the control board it has, how many tracks you need. After you select your studio and you know where you're going to go cut, then you have to select tunes, and this is what songs are you going to convert from a pop tune over to a square dance. This, in my opinion, is very important. Some people are absolutely fantastic at hearing a song and say, that is a perfect square dance. I think Don Williamson will agree with me, one of the finest anywhere in the country is Cherry Haig. Everything he touches turns to just a good song. You can attest to that fact by seeing the songs he comes out with. Some folks do a fantastic job of recording, but they don't necessarily pick out good songs, you know, and somebody will suggest it to them. The tune selection is very, very important. We could go in and arrange almost any piece of music that's ever been made any time and cut it into a square dance. Might not sell, might be tacky, might be in poor taste, but it can be done. We as producers have to maintain the right or retain the right to refuse to cut certain songs based on either their being, in our opinion, not good danceable pieces of music, pieces of music in poor taste, whatever we might think, all right? For example, I don't touch religion, booze, sex, or divorce. I'll leave them alone because this reviewer is going to go zip when it comes out in the magazines, okay? Every once in a while we slip, but we try to stay away from it. Unless, you know, maybe it's in a humorous vein or it's very, very light. This is a decision you have to make, all right? For example, there is a song out right now I think is fantastic. It's by Shelley West called Jose Cuervo. You are a friend of mine. I'm not going to cut it, but I sure do want to. I got to tell you, I won't do so bad, I can't stand it. But I won't. I won't do it. I don't think. Anyway, you just, it's luck, and then you rear back, okay? I heard, Don and I were talking yesterday, we had a session in Nashville in December, and on the way over there, driving from Gatlinburg to Nashville, I hear this thing called Swingin' by John Anderson, right? I flipped out, so I walked into Ernest Tubb Record Shop there out there in Nashville, and I said, I want John Anderson Swingin'. He said, we don't have that. I said, yeah, you do, I just heard it. No, we don't. I said, well, have you got Wild and Blue? Oh, yeah, we got that on an album. I said, well, that's his latest album. So they're tucked neatly away in band number five is Swinging. So it was cut there by the engineer in the band I use in Nashville, and I took it in there, and I said, you guys out of your tree. I said, you put that garbage three-beat waltz out as a single, which I don't, and I said, you missed the hottest thing going. And it was cut as a comedy relief. It was cut at by John Anderson. So needless to say, they put it as a single. Don's done a fantastic job of cutting it. Elmer did a good job of cutting it. Two different styles. Again, as I said before, here's two labels, got the same song, two entirely different way. You have your option of picking which one you like best. They're both good. It's the styles that are different. So you pick out which style fits your style the best and jump on it, okay? I'm fortunate they both sent it to me, and I'll call one night, the other one the next night. And I like it that way. But you've got to be lucky. I was there, I had the song, ran out of time, and didn't cut it. Glad I didn't, but I like their job on it, all right? So, but it's very important that you select your tunes. All right, people say, why don't we cut more of Elvis's things? Or why don't we cut more 1950s rhythm and blues things? Not the hardcores, but the nice ones, the Buddy Hollies, the Jerry Lewis things, the some of the Dionne Belmont, some of the real nice things. Rhythm and blues were cutting phrasings, okay? They were cutting 4-bar phrasing, well, actually, 12-bar phrasings. Now, or 24 beats to a group, okay? If you'll notice that the opener and the middle break on Hooked on Elvis, if you ever heard it, Hound Dog and the Teddy Bear, is 48 beats. If you take, it's in 24-beat phrases, and that's all they are. If you add 24 more to it, you've got 72, so you've got them home, and they're going to stand there and wait around for about 8 beats. Or if you make it 64, it means you've got to take 24 and 24 and 16, which means you're doing two-thirds of one of the phrase, as baby, won't you be, and then you go to head square through four, because that's all you can sing. You just run out of beats. So this is the reason we don't do a whole lot of Elvis or 50s type thing. Most of the rhythm and blues were cut in 24-beat phrases, and you, I gotta think of a better word. I don't like that word. You chop it up too much, and you lose the flavor of the original song. And if you're going to cut When You Wore a Tulip, and it comes out sounding like Mountain Dew, why cut When You Wore a Tulip to begin with? So anyway, this is the reason that we must. The closer, if you can pick a song that's in 16-beat phrasings, 32-beat phrasings, or 64, obviously, then you just lay it out. And so many Conway Twitty, Statler Brothers, Oak Ridge Boys, that's the way they cut them. Country music is cut right there on that 32-beat phrasing. You just pick it up and run with it. So that's the reason there. Just pick a tune, and I'm going to take off here and go a little faster. Then you got to find musicians. In order to pick musicians, you have to know what instruments you want. Now, obviously, I won't say obviously, because it varies. We have one label that uses one man, and he plays multiple electronic synthesizers and things like this and brings up a whole band that's just one fella there playing. Or you can go and do the whole thing, as I do. All right, I need a drummer and a bass man, a rhythm guitarist, and a keyboard man. That's my rhythm tracks. All right, then I want a banjo. I happen to like a banjo. I like fiddle, so I hire a fiddle player. I like steel guitars, so I hire a steel guitar. I got to have a lead guitarist to hire him. And I happen to like harmonicas, too, if I can find somebody that can play the thing, besides Bill Peters. And so you put a band together, all right? Now, you're as advantageous to you to find musicians that play more than one instrument. For example, when you go to Nashville, you pay union scale to each of your musicians. But if a musician can do what they call a double, that second instrument doesn't cost you so much. So I've got a lead guitarist that plays harmonica. I've got a steel man that plays dobro. I've got a fiddle player that plays mandolin. And I've got a rhythm guitarist, Bobby Thompson, that plays banjo. So I've covered 8 instruments with 4 guys. All right. And then Pig Robbins, the band leader, plays a regular keyboard, electric keyboard, and organ. So I've already gone from my 7 instruments up to 15, and I still have 7 pickers. So you hire the best musicians you can, but also you have to hire smart. So now I've got a studio, and here's the tunes I'm going to do, these are the instruments I'm going to use, and here's the musicians that are going to play them. So now you sit back with your tunes and say, what am I going to do? I have to write arrangements, or get someone to write arrangements for me. Now, I happen to write my own. Nobody ever told me I couldn't, so I just started, and I just do it that way. But some folks sit down, you know, like Don, you can sit down and you write your own arrangement. You just figure out, how am I going to put the thing together to make it sound the closest to the original sound and yet fit the phrasing requirements for square dancing. So, you can do it any number of ways. The problem you run into is when you get a song that can be done, well, the best thing that can happen is you say, this is the only way the song can be done. That's great, takes away decision time, you just do it. It's when you say, you know, I can do that thing about 6 different ways, and Lord, you don't know which one is going to be the way, and it makes no difference which one you pick, the other one was better. You know, it never fails, all right? Swinging is an excellent example. Don in one arrangement, and he decided to put the swinging and the hangovers on the back end, all right? Junior with ESP put swinging, he decided to put swinging on the weave of the ring. See, I really did this, I really did from both. And they're 2 different styles, both work, both are excellent. You pick which one you want to use. And frankly, there's about 3 more ways you could have done Don record too. So you can do it. You get in that dilemma and you've got to say, all right, which one is going to give me the flavor of the song, satisfy the phrasing and beat requirements for square dancing, and yet be the absolute easiest for the worst caller in the whole world pick up and call. Okay? And because that's where it's at. That's the whole thing is selling records. And if a record is perfect, it should be a record that's so popular that every caller already knows the melody to it. It should be a record that's recorded so well that the music feels and all are just going to make him sound like Elvis or whoever he wants to sound like. And it's got to be recorded and the choreography in such a fine choreography and the cue sheet written up so well that he can put the needle on, pick up that cue sheet, and call it, reading that thing right off the bat and get done and sound better than he's ever sounded in his life. That's a perfect record. Wish I had one. Right. But that's the way it should be. So you write arrangements. You decide, do I want an 8-beat intro? Do I want to copy the record exactly? Do I want a 16-beat tag, 8-beat tag, whatever you want? But you come up with an arrangement, and you say, this is the way I'm going to cut it. You hire your studio and you set up to go. Now you have rules. I call inviolate rules, rules that I don't care what you do not violate them. Occasionally, every once in a while, all of us will wander off and say, well, in this case, I've got to do it. Every single time you break one of these rules, you get burned. It never fails. Rule 1, your tempo has got to fall between 128 and 132 beats a minute. If you get too slow, they're going to tell you it's too slow. If you get above 132, they're going to tell you it's too fast. It's got to be in that bracket because that's, I think, is a proven fact that that's where square dancers worldwide enjoy. That's the speed they want to move their feet. Okay, and that's where it's at. That's 1. Phrasing. 64 beats, 7 times through, never, ever change. And I look at myself every day in the mirror and say, never change. And then I'll cut something and throw those 2 extra beats in the middle because I just figured I got to have it. You put it out and it don't work. For example, I did a thing called If I Keep On Going Crazy. Music is super, but you have to hiccup twice in the middle when I give it time to get there because I got cute and decided I was going to put a 2-beat turnaround. Every time you do, you get burned. The man says, 64 beats, 7 times through. I don't care what happens. That's what it is, all right? When I started my business, Norm Burbach told me, he said, whatever you do, 64 beats, 7 times through. You just don't change it. I've changed it 3 times. I got burned 3 times. I'll never change it again. I promise. I just won't, all right? The melody. You must have a melody in there somewhere. It would be lovely if every one of the 8,000 or 9,000 callers around the world were fantastic singers and could carry a tune and everything. It's not the case, and the object is to sell records. Now, the melody true. It doesn't have to be way up here hammering in your ear, but it has to be discernible on the instrumental side so that the, you know, a lot of guys say, well, he can turn it over and listen to the caller and hear the melody. That's great, but that doesn't help him while he's in the middle of that song. So somewhere on an instrumental side, you've got to have the melody, and it's a very fine line between too loud and too soft. You've got to have it subtle so they can feel it, they can follow the tune, but it can't get in their road or jump up and get in the way. But it does have to have melody lines on the instrumental side. That's rule number three. Four, you must establish some sort of 2-4 rhythm. That is boom, chuck, boom, chuck, boom, chuck, boom, chuck. You can hide it, disguise it, do everything but bury it, but you got to have it. It can be a boom, boom, a boom, chuck, a boom, chuck, a boom, chuck, or the boom, tick, tick, boom, ta. Do however you want to do. There's got to be a down, there's got to be an up. People come and say, why don't you cut Waylon Jennings songs? And I say, well, I'll tell you why. Waylon Jennings has got 1 foot. That's the one that goes down. He doesn't have one that comes up. It goes just like that. And you cut them, and the dancer steps with his foot, and the upbeat kicks him in the rear, makes him go, and he got to go boom, chuck, boom, chuck, boom, chuck. He just won't dance if you don't have it. That's rule number four. Now, let me rephrase this. As I said this morning, Ben Franklin said, when you start any sentence with "in my opinion," you're never wrong. This is all in my opinion. All right? Now, set up your studio. Normally, your tape speed is rather important. Now, I'm speaking of tape speed at the studio. You can record, well, normally it runs 15 inches per second, 7.5 inches, which is half of that, 30 inches per second, or 60 inches per second, or you can go to 120. Now, when you get up even to 60 inches per second, that tape machine is going, phew. You get 2 tunes on 1 whole roll, and that's all. We normally cut at 15. I guess that's what y'all do the same thing, 15 IPS, or 15 inches per second is tape speed. Most of your tape recorders, you'll see, reel-to-reel play 7.5, and most of your cassette players play 1 7. Yeah, 1 7/8, all right? Slow. This is why you do not get the fidelity out of a cassette recorder that you'll get out of a reel-to-reel. The slower it goes, the more pronounced the tape hiss, tape noise, wow, flutter, this type of thing is going to be. So when you're in that studio, you want that tape cooking, because the last thing you want to hear is, you know, going like this. And we're 10 years away from digital recording on a reasonably financial basis. We can do it now, but it's too expensive. So you want to at least get your tape speed up 7.5, 15 inches per second minimum. Now, then you use your engineer. That's where your engineer comes in. He's got to know how to most effectively mic your instruments. Where does he put the microphone to best pick up a tom-tom or a kick drum? Does he put a pillow in the middle of your kick drum? Does he put a pillow and a blanket? What sound do you want out of there? Do you want it to go, here, or do you want it? You can get any sound out of any instrument you want, almost. And you've got to sit in there and to say, hey, this is what I want these instruments to sound like, all right? If the man is good, he'll be a pro on frequencies and frequency responses. And if you want, for example, you want a woodblock doing that, you want a kick drum doing this, he's going to tell you frequencies are too close and you're not going to hear them. They're all going to come out like that anyway. All right? So he can advise you, and if you try to, you know, micing your instruments is very crucial in how you set it up. A lot of them, your electric guitar, bass guitar, so on, are microphones straight to the board. You can't control it anyway. It's when you have a microphone that's picking up the sound through air. All right? Some things just sound better. A rhythm guitar just sounds better with that loose ringing sound rather than mic'd in direct, in my opinion. All right. So you've got your instruments mic'd. Everything's wired to the board. Pickers are sitting at you, looking at you like you know what you're doing. All right? And you have to assign leads. Who plays the melody? Who plays? Everybody knows who plays the rhythm. All right? But you got to let them know what kind of rhythm. You can take a rhythm guitar and have it go ding, 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 or you can have it go boom, ching, boom, ching, or chinka, 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 chinka. It all effectively gives you the same rhythm, but it's going to sound different. And you've got on each one of these tunes, hopefully before you go in, if you can't decide before you go in, trust your musicians. If your musicians are any good, they want to sound good, and they won't lead you astray. Use their ideas as to what's going to sound good but let them know that I want this record to sound as close to this pop record as I can possibly get it. I want it to sound just like that dude, except with square dance danceability. All right? So, for example, if you're going to do... all right, good example. All right? First, what? All right, for example, this record, John Addison did this thing up there, and he used a whole bunch of horns, okay, as far as, and it gives him a, it's a not a big band sound, it's an old, well, I'll tell you what it is, it's an old black rhythm and blues sound is what it used to be, because it used to play a lot of rhythm and then have the horns come behind it. Thank you. Without those horns, you're going to lose the flavor. So you might go in, and I've had it happen to me. You go to a studio, he said, hey, man, I can't find any good trumpet players, so we'll fix it with something else. Oh, no, that song goes, we'll do it next month. Because without the horns, why do it? It's not going to be the same song. All right, so if you're going to go do any tune, if it's basic feel, is that of a type of guitar, you best put it in there. Because if you don't, it's not going to sound like the same song. You can cut any song with a boom chuck, boom chuck, boom chuck. But 20 years ago, that all the dancer wanted to do was have a rhythm and dance a lot of patter. When they look on that stage right now, they not only want to see an entertainer, they want you to sound as close to what they hear on the radio with the pop singers as possible. Now, we can't all do that. But at least they'd like for you to approach it. And you can't approach it if we don't cut the music that way. So, when you select lead instruments, all right, maybe the basic theme is a rock and roll tune with piano, okay? So, use piano for your opener, your middle break, and your closer. That's the basic theme. Then whatever you want to for the side figures and head figures, to play a melody, something that's not going to jump in the way, that kind of fits the overall feeling. But that opener, break, and closer is what sets your mood for that song, and it's got to follow the original, in my opinion. All right, now, so you picked out your lead instruments, they're all ready to go, and you lay your bed down. Some folks, some producers, will go in and cut nothing but the rhythm sections on all the songs, and then come back and lay the leads. Some lay them all down at one time. I like to lay them all down at one time. I want everybody feeling their way along. And then after the song is laid down, then I'll come back and overdub where I think is necessary. If I need an additional rhythm guitar, or I want a little lick on the guitar here, or the steel needs to... For example, the piano, will, his first time through, the piano will always do a rhythm track. Then he'll come back and overdub his lead. But the steel guitar does not play rhythm tracks. So the first time through, he'll play his leads right on through. The lead guitarist will play his leads all the way through. All right? This type of thing. So... The whole point is you've got to put it down, and once it's down, then you go back and listen and say, all right, what else do I want to put on? Do I want to overdub the tambourine? Okay? I don't play a tambourine. I play the tambourine when I don't think I'm capable of playing. So I play the tambourine on ours. But you don't do it while they're cutting. Gotcha. Okay? Because it just makes noise. So you've gated it down. You do a pre-mix, mix it down, send the thing off to whoever masters your records. He'll make a dub. It's a big old thing about this, and let's pick around, it'll have one or more records on it. And it's merely to send back for you to use, to work with, work out choreography. Once the choreography is worked out, you've got it down, you go in the studio again, lay your vocals down, backup vocals if you so desire, and then you do your mix down. I cannot begin to go through the technical aspects of mix down. Some people have engineers that do the mixing. I happen to do my own mix downs. But the mixdown is where you make your record. That's where the taste and the hearing comes in. You sit there and you blend all of those tracks to get the sound that you want. I can't tell you how, you just rear back and guess. Okay, it's a matter of knowing how to operate the equipment. If you're working with an engineer, you try to communicate to him what you want to sound like, and as it plays, say, no, change this, change that, and you hope you're right. You get your mixdowns, you send it off to the mastering lab. Hopefully he masters it and cuts an acetate master that's close to what your tape was. You send it out and they take it and dip it in molten nickel and they make a plate out of it. That plate is sent to the pressing plant, and the records, little black wads of vinyl come out, and they stamp the record just like you would a waffle, and it comes up through, and it goes through a little thing where they trim it off, and the labels come on, it goes on. We put it in a sleeve and send it to you, and pray to God you buy it. And that's where it's at. Thank you.
And there you have it. Okay, before we break up, is there any questions or additions anyone would like to make at this time? Yes, Bob? Can you get...
Here. I just want to ask Wade and you and Doc here, how much emphasis do you place at the present time on intros, key changes, and endings?
Repeat the question.
The question, as I understand it, is how much emphasis do you place on intros, modulations, key changes, and endings?
Right.
Okay. As Wade said, his approach is to get as close to the original rendition as possible. If the original rendition has a modulation or key change in it, you can bet your sweet bippy that his is going to have a modulation at the same place that the original is, because that's what he's trying to do. Again, I think you might think about the effect that you're trying to create. Don't be cute. Do it right, because you're not there to be creative as you make a record. You're there to give the folks what they can use effectively. The standard 8-beat introduction is always safe.
I'm not trying to ask a question that is to try to trick anybody. My concern is that so many records that we receive today, some of them are very difficult as far as intros as to getting into the melody line.
All right, I think, and I'm sure Don will agree with me, we attempt, and now they may be 16, they may be long intros, but with rare exceptions, I don't think you'll find any off-number intros. You may find some oddball tags, but on the intros, we try to stick 8 and 16 because I think it's vitally important. I made one with a 12-beat intro, and it's crying shame, but it was a mistake. On the tag-outs, as Bob and I talked earlier today, so many of the songs don't just have a four-bar tag anymore like they used to. They've got an eight-bar tag on the end. If you don't do it all, you lose so much flavor of the song. And yet, I know the last eight out of our last 10 have had that long old tag on there, and I don't like it either. But it's pretty. I hate to throw it away. So, it's a decision you have to make.
Okay. I don't know whether we have a lot of other callers beside myself who find it very difficult to sing, but it seems like the latest batch of records for the last few years are coming out with such a tremendous driving beat and no melody. Is it possible to get more melody for us poor devils that have a hard time singing?
Well, yes, it is. However, if I had my way about it, I'd put all the melodies, do away with them, because you'll never hear a pop song or country song. They just don't have leads on records that you hear on the radio. But as Wade said, you do have to put it in there, but you have to make that choice. And of course, it would vary with the song. Yes, this real hard rhythm with the hot bass drum is very popular, and I know what you're saying. And on certain songs, I think we will try to do that. We have to be careful not to get too much melody, and that's about all I have to say about it. Would you?
It is. I think, and never to what Jimmy said, we did get away from it too far. Whoops, I'm sorry.
I think that Jim is right. We did for a while get away from it too far, but this is something we discussed last year, and I think you'll be finding a change over the next few months. I know I've got a batch right there that we just got in Nashville, and I specifically almost overstated it, really. I'm going to have to play them down. Because a caller, now a caller's tone deaf, that's one thing, but sometimes I find if I don't know the melody of that thing, I'll call a 16th of a beat late, and I'll hear what he's going to do first, and I'll come do it right behind it. And if it's not there, I can't. So it is important, and it's just a matter of we've got to make sure we keep our act clean. That's all.
Another point on that, thank you, Jim. on that intro, very often, of course, you want to capture it as much like the original as possible. However, you do have to make some sacrifices sometimes, but we've found very often we put in a lead-in, do your eight beats or perhaps your five beats, or if you're going 16, you'd leave enough so you could go bum, 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 lead the caller right in there. He can't help but start on the right beat. And we think of those things. Are there any other comments? I'd like to say a great big thanks to our panelists. Let's have a nice hand for Carl Anderson, Wade Driver. And we certainly appreciate your attendance. We hope you've gained something from our session. Thank you.